Chapter 1, Tops and Measuring It. There are two common systems of measurement, metric and imperial. Having had a weird international upbringing, I have no idea which one I'm supposed to use in any given country, and I don't know how to convert them to one another without the internet, but basically, metric does centimetres and imperial does inches, I think. Neither measurement is wrong, they both work, and they can be translated back and forth from one another. There's no absolute measuring system created by God to be the right measuring system. So what we often call the LGBT community hasn't always been defined that way. There have been different systems of measurements at different times in different cultures. For example, in ancient Rome, there was no divide between gay and straight for men, but more like a divide between tops and bottoms, in a very problematic way. It could be that some ancient Romans could be described as gay or bi, but it was just a very different social system, which rather than valuing straight over gay, it valued top over bottom. So LGBT is a very particular system of measurement, like the metric system. It's not perfect, it's not absolute. God didn't say, and let there be LGBT. The line between gay and bi is actually quite blurry, and the line between bi and straight is also quite blurry. But that's true of anything in life. We draw lines around spectral colours, even though those lines don't really exist, but it can be helpful for us to communicate about them. LGBT as a term evolved slowly. Originally we had the gay movement, and then the gay and lesbian movement, and then, as recently as the 90s, organisations began to buckle to the pressure to include bisexuals and trans people, who were often excluded from gay spaces and activism for the sake of respectability. LGBT is often then extended to include other groups, such as intersex people, for instance, LGBTQIA+. The Q is kind of an odd addition to LGBT, as it refers to queer people, a group who commonly identify with other letters of the initialism and can refer to sexuality and gender. Traditionally, it comes with a more radical political perspective than the mainstream LGBT movement. The word queer is intentionally vague, and in that sense, it's almost the total opposite of mogai. Mogai is another system of measurement that's much newer, like the imperial to our metric. Mogai stands for marginalized orientations, genders, and intersex. Where LGBT focuses on our similarities, the things we have in common, the broad social groups we fit into and can find community with, mogai is more about individualism and the smallest differences between us. For example, abrosexual refers to an individual who is sexually fluid, slash has a fluid and or rapidly changing sexuality that fluctuates between many different sexual orientations. A novosexual person is someone whose sexuality fluctuates along with their gender identity. In an LGBT system of measurement, you would say that these people are bisexual and the latter is trans, specifically non-binary. Where LGBT is a response to systemic oppression, labels like lesbian and transgender being used to indicate one's position in a homophobic, transphobic society, terms like novosexual are more about finding a personal identity one can enjoy with a personalized flag. There's really a lot of nuance to the differences in mogai, and I think people who identify more with the mogai system are more invested in finding the differences among themselves to form something very personalized. I think this may also be where the whole thing of like non-binary is not trans comes from. In the LGBT community, we had a whole thing years back where we started using an asterisk to signify that trans included non-binary, until people started pointing out that, like, of course trans includes non-binary, so why would we use the asterisk? And we stopped using the asterisk, and now people are saying non-binary and trans are two different things. Recently I've had people reply to my posts online just saying, non-binary has nothing to do with being trans, and trans is just something completely different. And I think maybe that distinction comes from mogai. There's a lot more to say about mogai, but I think I'm gonna save it for another video. Chapter 2, Bisexuals and Pansexuals Fight to the Death. Now, I would like to talk about bisexuality and its relationship to these two systems of measurement. Within LGBT, bisexual has always been considered an umbrella term for people who are neither gay nor straight. Under LGBT, a pansexual person also counts as bisexual because that is the term we use to unify for the social cause. Bisexual organizations all over the world generally use bisexuality in this context, working with people of any identity who fits under the vague, broad definition of bisexuality. Bisexuality has also been described in this broad, open way historically. Bisexual was always intended to be an inclusive term. Within mogai, however, a pansexual is never bisexual, and it is extremely offensive to say that they are. Bisexual is never considered an umbrella term. Some consider bisexuals only capable of being attracted to two genders, but any two, so a person could be attracted to just demi-boys and just agender people, but no one else. and that makes them bisexual. Or a bisexual is only attracted to 2+ genders, but not all genders. So they can be attracted to every single gender that exists, minus one. This version of bisexual is considered inherently limited, and it's positioned under the multiple attraction spectrum. MAS stands for multi-attraction spectrum. I've also seen multi-gender attraction. Bisexuality in this system refers to someone who's attracted to two genders, but potentially 2+, with the intention of focusing on the etymological root of the word and making sure two remains part of the definition. Mogai is really in love with Latin roots. Other words in the multi-attraction spectrum, which would otherwise be included under the bisexual umbrella in the LGBT system, include polysexual, omnisexual, pansexual, pronoun sexual, speciosexual. What's interesting about Mogai terms is that they often don't distinguish from one another based on who they are attracted to. A polysexual, an omnisexual, a pansexual, and a bisexual can all be attracted to absolutely anyone of any gender on Earth. Obviously, under the LGBT system of measurement, who you're attracted to is incredibly important and it revolves around that because that is how systemic oppression works. But that's not how Mogai systems work. And honestly, I'm surprised that these bisexual, polysexual, omnisexual, and pansexual are the most popular words in the multi-attraction spectrum. I would expect it for it to be more prominent, that you would be like, I'm attracted to people of any gender, but only masculine people or feminine people, because those are two really distinct groups of people. But the following distinction is actually much more prominent in the community. A bisexual and a polysexual under Mogai are incapable of loving just any gender. I've received a number of comments on my YouTube videos telling me that a specific number of genders exist and a bisexual is incapable of loving them all, but can love all minus one. Obviously, that is very different from the LGBT system of bisexuality. The difference between omnisexual and pansexual is that omnisexuals are attracted regardless of gender, but are not gender blind. So they can see gender, but pansexuals are attracted regardless of gender and are gender blind. So a pansexual and an omnisexual could date all the exact same people, but the pansexual would experience the relationship differently because their attraction can't register the difference between the genders. So the behavior of all these groups, the people they date, may be exactly the same, but there are tiny nuances which wouldn't affect the gender of who they date, but may have some internal sense of difference. The term bisexual, as used by the community in the 20th century, had no sense of distinction. There were as many ways to be bi as there were bi people, and although the antiquated word, already a century old at the time, may be something of a misnomer, there's no doubt bisexual is meant to encompass all forms of attraction which exist regardless of gender. Chapter 3. So am I pronoun sexual or what? So what's my sexual orientation? Thanks for asking. Well, by the LGBT definition, I'm definitely bisexual, and that's mostly the term that I use for myself. But I found that when I use bisexual in an LGBT sense, people often interpret it in a Mogai sense. I've been informed by people that I cannot be bisexual because I'm attracted to trans people or because I'm attracted to non-binary people, but none of that makes sense in an LGBT context. So in a Mogai sense, I am pansexual or omnisexual. I don't honestly know which, because I do see people's genders, but I don't choose my partners based on their gender. But for example, abuse from men in my childhood has led me to be more wary of men, even though I am attracted to them. So I suppose that trauma might make me omnisexual rather than pansexual, even though I still am attracted to men and I would date a man. But there's an important component to these identity politics, Mogai in particular, and that is choice. What do I want to identify as? I've seen this also lead to infighting. For example, there's a debate among demisexuals as to whether demisexuals are capable of enjoying pornography. So some people who identify as demisexual don't, and some do, and that leads to differing opinions on what a demisexual is. So if I prefer to call myself a pansexual, I may dilute what it means to be a pansexual because of my trauma. And within the pansexual online community, there are various debates and interpretations as to what a pansexual person is. In theory, a pansexual is attracted to people regardless of gender and doesn't see gender. However, many pansexuals say that it is possible for pansexuals to have a gender preference. I choose not to use Mogai labels for myself. I have in the past used pansexual though. There was a time at the beginning of the last decade when non-binary people were starting to get more attention in the media and online, when people accused anyone who used the word bisexual of being exclusionary of non-binary people, and actually just transphobic in general. I made a video about this at the time back in 2012 when I was only beginning to come out as non-binary, though I had been out to myself and a few others since I was a teenager. I argued then that bisexuals had a history of being told what we are allowed to be and what we're not allowed to be that we are always told that we have to choose another word for ourselves. And that had a big impact on my reluctance to switch to pansexual, because demanding this of me felt like biphobia. I think at the time, Mogai hadn't fully formed, and the debate really centered around which prefix was more appropriate: bi, which means two in its etymological root, or pan, which means all. Since then, Mogai has become distinct, and instead of settling on whether or not bi or pan was the more appropriate word, we separated into different communities with different flags and everything. I have found that pansexuals will sometimes refuse to be involved in, like, bisexual projects or come to bisexual events because they believe they're being excluded by the use of the word bisexual, even when it is used as an umbrella term and explicitly includes them. But it really depends. The word bisexual in LGBT measurement includes anyone attracted to anyone. Bisexual is not a limited word. And I think generally when it comes to like organizations and programming, the people who are organizing bisexual events are not the kind of bisexuals who think bisexual means only two genders. Chapter 4. Bisexual is chips. Gay and lesbian communities are distinct from one another in that they are attracted to very different groups of people. Lesbians are attracted to women, gay men are attracted to men. The bi community is less distinct from either of them, and bisexual people, no matter what their gender is, all have the potential to date people of any gender. For various reasons, gay people benefit from having a distinct community from the straight community. They benefit from accessing different resources. Bisexuals are defined by the weird experience of needing or fitting into both gay and straight categories. Those are the clear differences between gay, straight, and bi. So when we distinguish an omnisexual from a pansexual, what is the material difference? At what point in their lives does an omnisexual require different community and different resources from a pansexual? I think pansexuals, even if they don't see gender, are capable of understanding and recognizing what gender is within their culture, and I don't see how these two groups of people would need to be separated in any context. I think a lot of the contemporary debate around bisexuality versus pansexuality comes from bisexuals who are attracted regardless of gender and pansexuals who are attracted regardless of gender, and there isn't usually a clear distinction between the people who fight about it and who they're attracted to. But I think the pansexuals of this debate are often Mogai pansexuals, and the bisexuals are LGBT bisexuals who are attracted to people regardless of gender, which are effectively the same group of people, but with different identity labels and different flags. It's possible to sometimes have two words for the same thing. Is it soda or pop? Are they galoshes or Wellington boots? Often the distinctions between synonyms like this is regional. A British person will say flat, while an American will say apartment. And I'm wondering to what degree the same can be said for pansexuality and bisexuality, that they're almost regional terms. The bisexual community can be traced back to real-life communities of people. The San Francisco Bisexual Center in the 1970s, Boston Bisexual Women's Network, and the UK BiCon in the 80s. Tracing back the history of the pansexual identity as a clear identity referring to attraction regardless of gender is traced back via the internet. Pansexuality, as the identity we think of today, wasn't born out of local communities, but out of internet communities. Words like gay will help you find a community of like-minded people out of the thousands of people who live in your city, but words like novosexual will help you find a tiny group of people online out of the 7.5 billion people on the planet. And what I see regularly is bisexuals like myself who have been doing real-world bisexual activism for over a decade coming online and finding pansexuals telling me that either I am not a bisexual and I was just foolish all this time, or that my bisexuality means my attraction is limited. I am British, but I lived formative years of my youth in the US and I stayed there for half my life. Crisps in America are called chips. Chips in America are called fries. So I end up stuck with this word chips, which can mean two different things depending on the context, which has led in my life to various moments of hilarity and confusion. I think bisexual is chips. You can quote me on that. Bisexual is chips. When I say bisexual coming from a culture of LGBT activism and IRL community, I don't mean the same thing that folks who learned their culture from online Mogai mean. And this leads to not only confusion, but very bitter online debates. Chapter 5. Validating transphobes. The biggest point of contention I find is whether or not a bisexual person can automatically be attracted to trans people. When we think about attraction to trans people, we can mean a few things. One, attraction to any kind of trans person. Two, attraction to men with vaginas and women with penises. Three, attraction to people who identify as neither a man nor a woman. And four, attraction to the concept of being with a person who is specifically trans. Kat Black recently made a video about her own experience with dating bisexual men and pansexual men, and in her experience, she can usually certify that a pansexual man will not have any concern about her transness, specifically her body as a trans woman, but with bisexual men, she can't make that assumption. And that's pretty true. You can't make an assumption about a bisexual person or a gay man or a lesbian as to what their boundaries are when it comes to trans people. In theory, there are a few different types of boundaries a person can have, such as 1, they are simply not attracted to men with vaginas or women with penises, or 2, they're a transphobe. Hypothetically, it is not possible to have either of these problems and identify as pansexual. Obviously, there are creeps and chasers who identify as pansexual sometimes, but the specificity of pansexual leaves less room for uncertainty as to whether the person will have problems actually dating or sleeping with a trans person. Under LGBT, that doesn't mean the pansexual isn't also bisexual, but under MOGAI, it would mean the person cannot be bisexual under any circumstances. So that leaves us in a situation which often becomes moralistic. Where a bisexual person could find trans people unattractive because they are a transphobe, they have a self-affirming label in the MOGAI bisexual. I find myself highly skeptical of anyone who isn't attracted to trans people, as trans people are a massive, incredibly diverse group of people. I find that when they try to affirm their lack of attraction to trans people, it usually means things such as erasing trans people who've had bottom surgery, or erasing non-binary people who aren't androgynous, or even just erasing trans people who don't medically transition in any way. Because there's no one way to be trans. And when people say that they're not attracted to trans people, it's usually because they have a fixed idea of what a trans person is in their head. It's like, there's cis people and there's chicks with dicks. I think it's often very difficult to make a call on your personal attraction to trans people, both because of the massive diversity among us and because there tends to be so much fewer of us around. If someone isn't attracted to me and I'm the only trans chick they know or a non-binary person they know of, then that isn't an indicator of their attraction to trans people. It's an indicator of their attraction to me. I think the question of, are you attracted to trans people, is one which is rarely so cut and dry to answer. We're all born into a very cis-sexist society with very few trans people around relative to cis people. To even be able to make that call is a very difficult one unless you have an exceptional interest in trans people. I find we often leave the word bisexual behind in favor of pansexual because we want to make clear our attraction to trans people. But when we do, it's possible that we are leaving a lot of space for unexamined transphobia. Transphobia is not a sexual orientation. If all lesbians stopped identifying as lesbian when they find themselves attracted to trans women, it would make the word lesbian inherently anti-trans, and I think that's a choice. There are trans women with vaginas, there are short trans women, there are trans women with big old titties, there are trans women with a Disney Plus account who'll share her password with you. Are you really not attracted to trans women? Or have you just not unpacked your own transphobia? When it comes to the bi versus pan discourse, I think it's time to take a step back from this identity politics and look at who we really are. Is this really two separate minority groups fighting one another? Or are we more or less the exact same group of people, divided only by the words that we choose and the flags that we choose? Does the importance of identity politics really outweigh the sameness between us? A rose by any other name? Although if you call it like a poop flower, I think that would affect psychologically the smell. I covered a lot of topics in this video, and if there's anything you would really like me to expand upon, let me know in the comments and I might do a future video on it. Like and subscribe! And also there's a little notification bell, I guess, so you can get notifications. So maybe press that too. Also, please check out my Patreon. If you'd like to support my videos, then you can support me via Patreon. And thank you, and I'll see you next time. Here I have a box with a cat in it. He's in his hair. Good girl, Snubby.